Peter from the Kia Hyundai channel. Welcome to our live video series. Today we have the Kia EV6 again, and this is going to be the full technology review. Now you're probably wondering why I did the screenshot of the doors open for a technology review, and to be blunt, I was trying to hide the dirt on it. So I got it dirty, and I got it dirty for a reason and left it dirty for a reason. So we'll talk about that in just a second. So here we go. We're going to go through a full technology review of this car, but just so you know, if you're joining us for the very first time, we do these videos live. It's about 2 o'clock. It is exactly 2 o'clock Eastern time, and this is a live video with live interaction. If you're watching it and you're not live with us, you could skip ahead to the 3 minute mark to get to just the technology part, but I'm going to continue to talk about a couple little things that we left out of yesterday's video, which you should also watch, which includes some things that I think should be in there. So first thing I'm going to do is show you how to join us live. Then we're going to go over a couple little things. And somebody just said, don't forget the keys. And I just double checked and I have them. So we're good. Then we're going to keep rolling here. So let me just show you what we're doing. All right. If you want to join us live, all you have to do is go to our YouTube page at exactly 2 o'clock. Like I said, it's 2 o'clock right now, Eastern time. And you'll see we have a traditional sort of regular video here that switches every now and then. But if you refresh the page when we're doing a live video at 2 o'clock Eastern time on a weekday, you will see our live video right there. You're going to click into that. You're going to have to watch a quick little ad. And I'm going to skip that ad. It looks like a very nice one. It has a picture of Toronto. All right, skipping that ad. Okay, so if you're in Ontario and you want to buy a vehicle from us, and especially an EV, I do encourage you to buy through us. You can reach us here. There are three dealers that support us. Brantford Kia, Owen Sound Hyundai, and Brantford Hyundai. So three dealers that support us. We can help you out. And there'll be a link in the description of this video soon after I'm done. You can reach out to me there and we'll go from there. All right. Normally I go over some news and notes. Let's just cover a couple little things I want to cover as well. You guys asked about a vehicle to load function on the inside of this car. I don't know if I can get a picture of it, but there it is there in the center of the rear seats there. So again, just in front of this centerpiece on the bottom inside, right in there, visually it's right inside there. That is the interior vehicle to load button. We'll talk about that later. Vehicle to load plug, excuse me. And down here is your vehicle to load sort of adapter type thing. And it is in a little case, which if I zip up, oh, I'd like to zip that up better. It fits in this case, which has your level one charger like that. That is a nice Velcroed thing there. And then a couple of you wanted to see the seats. They do have different reclined settings there. So that's kind of a normal upright. That's all the way back. We can flip them both down by pulling the handle on the side here. We'll do that. And we're gonna throw a teddy bear in here just for the sole reason that some people wanted to see this with the tailgate down and the cargo cover removed. If you're wondering where the cargo cover is, it does fit underneath the seat right in this area here. So again, if you're wondering what I'm talking about, yesterday we showed the cargo blind, which plugs into there and runs across here, and it's like a blind that keeps your cargo covered. People wanted to know if like the Niro EV goes underneath the floor. It does. Let's take Teddy Bear for a second here. Teddy Bear is my trunk measurement tool. I will throw him in lengthwise this time, and we'll put him right up against the passenger seat, which is actually quite a ways back right now, this passenger seat. There's those seats there, and there's Teddy Bear in there. So 3.5 minutes in, we're gonna go to the technology portion of this video right now, but I just wanted to show you a couple things that people asked in the comments. Another quick note is I have a scheduled day or two off Monday and Tuesday, so I will be here Wednesday next week. There'll be no live video on Monday and Tuesday. And those of you who've been trying to reach out to me since I did the video yesterday, whether it be Instagram, whether it be email, voicemail, forgive me because I haven't been able to get to every one of them. I'm certainly behind in the comments as well. I've been spending a ton of time just trying to figure out details behind the scenes on this car, and that can take some time, and yeah, so that's where we're headed. All right, one little quick little tech note I just wanted to show you that was interesting to me. This is an internal document. But if you get the way this works is if it's an all-wheel drive, it has a separate motor up front. And this whole platform is really intriguing to me. There's lots to learn about it and lots I'm gonna share with you in future videos as well. Interesting to me, if you get the rear-wheel drive, it's 225 horsepower on that engine. But if you get the all-wheel drive, the rear engine is 221 horsepower. Torque is the same in every trim line. So there's that. And then of course, if you combine with a front motor, you get a combined output of 320, but that front motor is 99 horsepower, 188 foot-pounds of torque. So just a little information there that I thought I should point out. Really quickly before we go too far, if you're interested in this vehicle, do me a favor and subscribe, leave a comment that you're appreciating these videos and like this video. That just helps us out. It also helps my bosses know that you want to see more of this. And to be blunt, I'm spending a lot of time learning things on this video. So it's going to bother me if I can't spend a whole bunch of time filming things on this video. So the more you guys like this and let our bosses know that you think these are great, even if they're not great, that just helps me make more videos for you. And I understand this is not entertaining, but I do try to be as informative as possible. So what we're going to do now is we're going to dive into the technology of this car. So yesterday what we did is we showed you that remote start, which is sort of remote climate, but in some cases on this one, it is kind of remote start. And we showed you we can move the car forward and back. The way I think I'm going to do this today is I'm going to introduce a number of technology features to you. Many of those technology features are going to require 5 or 7 or 10 minute videos on all of the sort of features that you have there. So what I'm going to do is introduce them, and then I want you guys to let me know in the comments, both live and otherwise, tell me some of the features that you're interested to see future videos on, and then I'll sort of prioritize based on popular opinion which videos to do, because some of these features, I could go over 3 features and it would be 10 minutes per, and then we'd only go over 3 features, and there's probably 100 to go through. So we'll just dive right in. Let's jump in right now. All right, people have played with this car. That's obviously ambient lighting is a different color than it was yesterday. Some of these settings may not be the same as they would be from the factory. I don't think that matters for our video, but in case you are wondering, oh, is that how it's set up from the factory? It may or may not be. So I'm putting my seatbelt on for no reason other than if I put this thing in drive or anything, I don't want it beeping. Okay, so first of all, digital dash. We talked about this yesterday, 12.3-inch screens. I don't know if I made it clear, but something like my Hyundai Santa Cruz has dual screens as well. They are dual 10.25-inch screens. 12.3 and 10.25 sound very close together, but they are very large screens. They are impressively large when you see them. And I think that's worth noting that there's a visual impression here of very large screens. I have tried to turn up the brightness on the heads-up display. You can see it there, but not very well because of the type of day it is. I can see it quite clearly in person, but you can see it there. We're going to talk a little bit about the augmented reality pictures in here. And the augmented reality information in here. But we won't be able to show it as well in this video, so we'll talk about that as well. And whoever's commenting that you have 3 EV6s in stock, anybody want one? You're lying, because if you have them in stock, they're sold. So don't do that. Don't pay attention to people in the live comments that are saying silly things. Okay, so let's jump through here. Okay, so again, charging isn't full. You can change this cluster. Really what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off over here. Now, this is a thing that's on every one of our cars pretty much now, certainly anything with a big screen. You can change the user here. I want to point this out simply for the fact that it's very important that as you start customizing this car for yourself, you may find if you share this car that some of your preferences on this are different than the preferences of your co-driver. And that's why it might make a difference to, I'm just gonna go back to the guest mode. It might make a difference to customize and set up your driver mode. So you can customize driver one as your name, driver two is their name. I'm gonna go to the guest mode and confirm just because we're gonna stay in that guest mode here. I think it was in the guest mode before. Yeah, it was. So we're gonna go back to that guest mode just to keep things there. But if you customize this car, as you'll see the things that I can do, keep in mind you may want to customize separately for different drivers who have different preferences in there. Somebody asked if this has ventilated seats or is that only the IONIQ 5. It does have ventilated seats. I can show them to you right here. In fact, I'll turn them on and I'll tell you when they start getting cold. So there they are. And again, I can feel the ventilation almost immediately. But I'll tell you if it cools me down quite a bit. They do blow a lot of air, and I'm already feeling it. So there you go. Okay, so what we're going to do now is there's just 100 ways to go about this. We're going to sort of swipe across. The home screen here is a little different than the purple theme that we used to have in every other, or we still have in every other car. They've changed from purple to this EV-ish blue, and your home screen is your battery scale. So you can see it's got about 39% right now, 171. Don't do the math on that so much because these people have been driving this at various ways and idling, and I can show you that in a little bit here. So one of the key technology things is just clicking into this EV menu. This has been in our car. Actually, my seat is getting too cold now, so I'm turning that off now. All right. One of the key things with this is a similar function in our previous vehicles, but it looks different. So the functionality is very much the same if you have a Niro EV or a Kia Soul EV like I do, but the look is a little different. You can see some charge stations are labeled in here. It is my recommendation that you download some of the apps on your phone for various charge stations. An example is ChargePoint, and I'm not recommending them over any other one, but ChargePoint has an Android Auto or Apple CarPlay app. The thing I like about that is they have in my area, they have chargers everywhere, and it gives you an idea of, you know, which chargers are available, which chargers are in use, that kind of thing. So you can just use your apps on your phone through Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, or you can use this. I just feel like this is a little bit less precise than I would appreciate. So there is that. All right, so we're gonna click into this car there, and then you can see some things that we can do on other cars as well. So if this car was charged fully in the winter here, it's predicting about 482 kilometers of range. Now that could be close, it could not be close. So there's examples here. This car, of course, is rated for about 441 as it sits. In the winter, I don't expect it to exceed 441. But again, we haven't put a ton of kilometers on this car yet. It's guesstimating, and we'll be able to do a bit of more better range projections in the winter a little bit later. What we can do on this screen, though, is this is fast charging, DC charging, and sort of normal charging, AC charging. What we've done here is we've set it down to 80%, and the way you do that is you just drag it. So some people say, and this is what I practice on my EV, I don't charge above 80% unless I need to. If I need to, I go there, and that's, you know, supposedly best practices for battery longevity. Now, I do want to point out, I have no information from Kia on the EV6, or if I do, I haven't seen it yet, of anything that says you should not charge beyond 80%. A lot of us who own EVs tend to charge 80 or 90% unless we need more. And the idea is you're not leaving it at 100%, driving it to 90%, charging back to 100%, down to 90%. You want to kind of go through the battery and that kind of thing. And you don't want to leave it stored at 100%. But again, when I say that, none of that is official about the EV6 that I can find anywhere in the stuff that I've read so far. So battery status stuff there, electricity use, you can see when you're driving the car, if I was to put this in drive right now, it would tell me that the drivetrain is using a certain amount of power. Yeah, I don't want to go too far. I'm in a room here, so I'm going to go back and just put it in park. But when I'm in that screen there, right now, the only thing drawing off the battery is essentially the electronics. If I turn on the climate control system here, which I will do right now, you'll see the climate will start to use some power, and that's coming to come on fairly strong. There we go, 0.38 kilowatts, 0.4 kilowatts it's drawing right now. So you can see, you know, and then it'll give you a percentage of the overall. As I do some driving, it'll show me how much the drivetrain is both using and adding in regenerative things. So just kind of little nerdy stuff here since we've turned the car on, how much percentage of our battery. And the idea is, hey, if my climate is using that much percentage, maybe I can go down here to a driver-only mode, or maybe I could turn the temperature up or down, whichever will affect it, or frankly, maybe I can just turn the whole system off and start saving some extra battery that way. Keep in mind here, we're not really worried about saving range in a car with this much range that charges this fast. It's just not an issue. Somebody says, what's the lifespan of the battery? That's a whole other video. It's designed to last the length of the car, and I will make a video on that and explain why and how and all those kinds of things, but it's not something we have to worry about today, but I will absolutely do a video on that in the future. Okay, let's jump back into the tech here. We're gonna skip some of this stuff here. What I want to do is just show you some of the kind of cool stuff in my books. So we're going to go to setup here. We're going to go to the vehicle setup here. And there's a lot in here. There's a lot of new things and interesting things. So this driver assistance menu is standard in all of our Kia and Hyundai vehicles, but they've kind of laid out your systems in a better menu kind of thing. So you have, for instance, the driving convenience setting. You can just click on in there, highway driving assist. We have highway driving assist 2, has lane change assist now, which is can automatically change lanes. Highway auto speed change, that kind of thing. Speed limit assist is in this car. I really like the speed limit assist. So basically what this is, the short form version of how it works, is you can set the cruise control. And in Canada, we don't drive the speed limit ever. Anybody. Not the police, not anybody else. They'll tell me I'm lying, but it's true. So, like, let's say you want to go 10 kilometers over the speed limit when you set the cruise control. If you set the cruise at 10 kilometers, it'll give you the option when it sees the speed limit, both through the navigation and through the camera in the front of the car, just above behind your mirror here. It'll see what the speed limit is, and you can set it. In my car, I have it set to 10 over. So it'll automatically set, it'll give you a button to tap that cruise button and set the speed limit to 10 over, or you can go 10 under or exactly on the speed limit, that kind of thing. It also gives you different warnings and visual aspects to show you speed limits and if you're 10 over or more or whatever you want it set to. So it is an advantage to be able to hit the cruise and know that it's going to keep the car at exactly, in my case, I keep it 10 kilometers over the speed limit. So I'm driving through Hamilton, which is near us. The speed limit goes to 90, and it can go up to a little bit more. Oops. You can still set the speed, the cruise control to 20 over if that's what you want to do. But just keep in mind the car can do it itself to up to 10 over, 10 under, that kind of thing. So I kind of like this screen just because everything's laid out very well. Blind spot safety, lane safety, speed limit assist, which we were just in, lane safety, we can see up here as well. Anything that says assist means it can actively steer the car for you to keep you centered in the lane or various other things. So blind spot safety, parking safety, rear active assist, those kind of things. Anything with an active assist generally steers or brakes the car for the most part. Drive modes here. Let's click on drive modes. You can set the brake modes. This is the regenerative braking mode, essentially. Normal is optimized for balance comfort, and sport is optimized for driving dynamic. You can set how the brake regenerative braking kind of works in there. The eco vehicle is interesting. So smart regeneration. So let's just talk about this for a second. There is a system down here. If you look at the level three there, LV3, that you can change with the paddle shifter. So I'm going to go up. Actually, I'll go to the other side. Switch hands here, Peter. We can do this. All right. There we go. So, oh, because I'm not in drive. Let's put it in drive. There we go. So level two, level one. So I'm changing my regenerative braking. So if you don't understand what that means, as you let off the accelerator pedal, or most people call it the gas pedal still, as you let off the accelerator pedal, the car is either going to coast or it's going to actively brake. You can set this to actively brake on one pedal driving. It's got an I-pedal type function. Let off the throttle and it'll slow down and come to a complete stop on its own. You still might have to hit the brakes, but if you do hit the brakes, it's because something's, you know, you have to hit the brakes because of something in front of you. A lot of time you can just one pedal drive, and you can set these over here, and you can set them on to various levels. Max, you can set it on to auto. You can do all kinds of different settings there. If it is on the auto system, so the smart regeneration system, you can customize how much regeneration it has. So strong, medium, gentle, and this will stay when you restart the car. So you can sort of set up the regeneration feeling that you want. It's pretty simple there. Charging cable stuff, you can keep it in here. Most people keep it locked while charging. So if you're at a charge station, nobody can unplug the charger while your car is charging. But I always keep it for do not lock in my house, so I can always unlock it. A little trick with the charging cable, all the doors have to be unlocked. If you're having trouble getting the charger out of the car, just unlock all the doors and it'll do it there. There's also voice prompts, and it will tell you, for instance, with a voice, it's say charging started. So you can set that to various levels or turn it off so you don't wake your neighbors or your family up when you plug the car in the middle of the night. Active sound design is something in here that, frankly, I'm not a fan of because I feel like it's a missed opportunity. So I'll tell you what it is. Basically, active sound design has various settings, various things that essentially kind of give a whoosh type sound as you accelerate and brake. Some people complain that electric vehicles don't make noise. So in this case, they make it make noise. I'm not a fan of the noise. It just sounds like extra road noise to me. So I would say for most people who like EVs are going to probably keep it off, but it's cool to play with and stuff, and you can do some custom sounds. Now, here's where I think the problem. You have Cyber provides a new futuristic electronic sound for electric vehicles. Great. Provides additional sound settings. You know, basically what I want to see is, I don't think you can do anything here. Yeah, you can't do anything that's cool. What you should do, what you should be able to do is... Now, I know these sounds are actually trademarked. Porsche trademarks their sounds, is what I've been told. But what you should be able to do is have it make it sound like a cool V8 engine or an actual fighter jet or something cool. These, to me, are just road noisy, whooshy, fake electric motor sounds, and they just sound like extra road noise in this car. But you can customize them, and you can play with them. And maybe you can tell me I'm wrong, and you guys like these types of sort of stylish, dynamic, and cyber. Like, a stylus provides the natural and refined sound of an electric vehicle. Sure, but it's extra sound. Provides a powerful dynamic sound for electric vehicles. Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with that marketing slogan. Cyber, same thing. So, but you can customize the sound, and you can make it sort of, you know, quite noisy or quieter, or turn it off like I did because it just sounds like road noise. So it's just something cool. Now, heads-up display is very cool. We've seen heads-up displays in vehicles before, and in this vehicle, again, a little hard to see here, but... it is very, there's a lot good with this, like a whole lot good with the heads-up display. So heads-up display in front of me here, you can see the reflection of the headlights. So that's a reflection of the LED headlights. They're flickering on camera, but this here is the heads-up display. So I'm going to play with a few things here. Oh, it's fading out. And that's what happens with these LED, with these heads-up displays. So we'll hopefully get it back here in a second. You can see some pretty cool stuff because they have an augmented reality mode. Now, I'll be blunt. I didn't think this would work very well, but it actually does work pretty well. So we're going to dig into the display control and more. We'll do the control first. So sync to the seat position so you can save the height. Basically, the heads-up display, one of the things it does very well is you can bring it down, you can bring it up. I love it exactly where it is. I'm looking at the vehicle in front of me, and I can see my speed as well. Now, I don't know if you can see it back here again. Yep, there we go. You can still see it back. It's going to fade in and out just the way the camera interacts with it. But yeah. Because you say that again. Oh, Siri thinks I'm talking to them. I'm not. Anyway, so you can see that up there, and you can really customize it. So the positioning is perfect. And then this AR matching. Oh, sorry, I got to zoom in and out here, guys. AR matching adjustment is pretty cool. So now you can do various things. So I'm going to try to film here. Let me just switch hands, zoom in. I'm going to try to show you some of this augmented reality while we're parked, and we're going to do a better video of this in the future, but click this thing. So there you can see the blue lines. Oh, it's fading. Let me see if I can just adjust this back. Let's try it again. Tell me when we can see. Oh, there we go. So we see it. So we hit the view. So there's your side street lines. And see that arrow going across? The blinking arrow? Hopefully you guys can see that. That's an example of what will happen in the navigation when it tells you to come across. The other thing with this augmented reality view is I intentionally drifted towards the left, the yellow line on the road, and it gave me little blinking arrows right on the line telling me, hey, turn back in. Like, it shows me the line. So the idea with augmented reality in the tech world is that you see something in front of you, and then it can project images in line with those things that it sees in front of you. And I kind of thought I'd refer to it as an advanced display, but it really does line up quite well with some things. I haven't tried all of it, and we will do a full video on this in the future. So why don't we pause there for a second? If you have some questions, we'll go through. We've got 178 people on right now. Do me a favor, hit the like button. Let's all of us hit it together. Let's blow through. I'd love to get to 300 likes. I know that sounds impossible. We've never done that. We did like 250s, 270, something like that yesterday. Let's see if we can get it to 300 likes. We'll have a whole bunch of people join us if we all hit the like button now. I'm going to take your questions. We're going to come back here and look at a few more tech things in just one second. I just want to make sure I'm including you guys in our tech side. Little questions I got asked. Does it have any memory seats? It does. Lots of things to talk about that way. But let's just make sure I don't have any. Oh, you know what? I've lost my connection on my computer here. For, give us one second, I'll pull up your comments. And like I said, I probably won't be able to hit all of them. Come on, camera. Come on, computer. Uh-oh. My computer's dead? Ha-ha! My computer's dead. My computer turned itself off. Okay, I can't see your comments in real time as much, so make sure you still leave them there. I'll go through them later and we'll keep asking questions. Memory for the passenger seat too? No, no memory for the passenger seat. I'm trying to catch your comments as they come through here, but I do apologize for missing them. My computer turned off somehow. I'm not sure how that happened. Let's just keep working through here and we'll keep going. Again, another 5-10 minutes, we'll show you some tech. And like I said, if you're looking for some tech that we haven't explained or that you wanna know more detail, feel free to ask for and we'll go through. Okay, turning the car back to the on position. Interesting thing about the button, the start button, it is over here. It does not say start stop. It's our first car that does not say start stop with a push button start. So we turned it on there. And a couple things we can do customize with the buttons here. This is a typical thing on most of our Kias. There's a star button that's hollow and there's a star button that's filled in. So the star button that is filled in is, where am I? Over here. I have to switch over here. There's the start button that is hollow right there. So you can customize that button. And there's one on the steering wheel that you can customize right there. And you can customize them to do various different things. Kia Connect, formerly known as UVO Intelligence. Quiet mode, we'll talk about that a little bit later as well. And you can customize this one. You can reroute things. You can voice memo things. Privacy mode, hands-free calling, reject or end a call. And that's the most common one, is reject or end the call, because you have the pickup and hang up. But again, you can use so many more things here, which is just kind of nice to have for that extra button. The mode button on the steering wheel, you can also customize what's included in that. So instead of switching just from AM to FM, you can go AM, FM, Bluetooth audio, phone protection. You could skip sounds of nature if you wanted to, do USB music if you had it in. And let's say you never listen to AM, FM radio. You could just go Sirius to FM and not include AM. So just kind of things you can do there. Interesting down here is a new thing on this car, volume and tune knob. Now I assume we'll see this on the new Sportage with the same type of system. But you can see right down here, I have a volume button on this side and a tuning button on that side. I could swap them. So let's hit the swap button right here and we'll just watch. See, that says file and tune, swap. Did it do it? There we go, I did it now. Oh, it didn't do it. Oh, hold on, so this is in various settings. So map and, oh, so you can change it in the map and the media and that kind of thing. So I'm gonna swap them back to where we had them. But yeah, you can change these volume and stuff based on various things so that these can do different things. You can swap them around. So just kind of a cool techie thing that you can do because you have sort of display type things. The remote parking buttons on the key fob, if you park with your wheels turned in, will it straighten the wheels? Yeah, so my understanding, we're going to do a whole series on remote parking because this car can actually kind of remote park. Let's just show you, let's see if I can do that here for a second. Oh, park. Let's hold the parking camera. Oh boy. Okay, so let's flip around here. Press and hold the button on display camera view, or press and hold to activate the parking system. So let me just show you that what it is again. So you can have this car park in many different ways. There's the key fob button, which we saw, and there's other ways as well. So we will do a video on how this car can park itself in various different ways. Essentially, if you're using the key fob, my understanding is it will straighten the wheels. It only goes straight back and forward on the key fob. But of course, if you use the other parking system in this car, which is not new, but it's new to Kia and the way it works, let me just flip around here. Again, you can set up that kind of stuff. So you can set that up to show up when I hit the camera button or not. I think I did show this yesterday, but in case you didn't see yesterday's video, this is kind of a cool feature. So again, we have that bird's eye view, and the way you get it is it uses cameras around the car, some of which are kind of dirty right now, and I do apologize I didn't clean them all off, but you can kind of take a peek. Oh, that's the wall beside me there. Yeah, I can see that wall there. Okay, what about over here? I can see over here. It worked better when I had cars in there, but you can kind of take a look around. There's the doors behind me there. There's the yellow sign for the wet floor sign. So kind of a cool thing. I don't know how practical this is to use, but I think it's pretty cool. You can see the headlights are on in front of me, and it's showing that as well on the wall. So it's very cool. The only issue I have with this is not the car I'm in. The car I'm in has a sunroof. The car I'm in is gray, cyber gray matte to be exact. And I feel like that's a software update away from being just perfect. I think this should be the color of the car is frankly my point of view. So that's kind of cool there. You can also see various views here, the backup camera, you look straight, you can have the wide angle, you can look straight down, or you can set this up to look down the sides of the car. So now you can have this look at the front wheels or the rear wheels as you're driving. If you're parallel parking, you can really see how you're lined up to everything there. So kind of a cool system there that kind of does literally everything that you would want. All right, I have a question about getting into the seating position. I have had a number of hip surgeries, and I was wondering if I can come in like SUV or more like a regular car. That's a great question. So EV6 looks sort of like a wagon car-ish. It looks lower than an SUV because it is, but it's not super low. The roof is lower than the IONIQ 5. I would say getting into it, it is not a low position at all. Probably similar to my Kia Soul, which again would be lower than the Seltos, but a very popular seating height type position. So it is certainly not sedan-like. It is higher than the K5. I think it's kind of the perfect mix. Driving this vehicle, definitely on the sportier side compared to the IONIQ 5 or everything else, but it is also something that does a very good job with the smoothing out the pavement. So it does very well that way. Tim's waving at me in the camera system here. You had to go through the room here. But yeah, so driving the car, while it leans sportier than the IONIQ 5, it is not a firm ride. It is something that it was very comfortable to me. I would quite enjoy driving this car. If you don't care about a sporty drive at all, the IONIQ 5 would be there. If a sporty drive matters to you, this is still very smooth, but this probably is something that would be there. Eleanor, you're speaking in French, and I apologize. I just can't remember off the top of my head what you're saying. My French is okay, but it's not good. All right, let's keep going through here. Technology. So one of the things that we talked about yesterday is the weird thing for me to get used to is this is where Kia has traditionally put all of this information, and the radio information used to be here, but it's now over here. The only thing I'll say is that after driving it today, oh, Evolution, he's gonna help me answer Eleanor's question because he speaks French. I appreciate that. One thing I will say about moving this over here is the driving functions. I tend to drive like this. I tend to have my left hand on the wheel when I drive with one hand, and sometimes I'm up on the thing. So my left hand seems to be always on the wheel. My right hand is sometimes on the wheel. So I kind of now agree with the driving functions are over here. When I want to turn on the smart cruise control, when I want to turn on the lane follow assist, that is my hand that's always on the wheel. And now I'm kind of wondering why my car doesn't have this. Flip side is radio stuff and phone stuff is stuff you touch occasionally, and that would make sense for me. So as I was driving, I kind of realized like this is where I want my driving controls for me. So I'm kind of on board with having the switch over here, the driving stuff over here, and the audio type stuff over here. Maybe I'm wrong in that. You guys can tell me about that. Somebody's asking about the rear seat space. Do you want me to hop in there? I can do that right now if you like. Teddy bear's still back there, so we'll do that real quick. And then, like I said, we only have about a minute or so left. I probably can't answer your questions just because my computer went dead, and I'm not sure why that happened. Oh, one thing I'll show you technology-wise. Those door handles come out as you approach the vehicle. If they're in, like right now it's in, or let's say they get frozen in. I know Teslas are just really difficult if they're frozen in, if there's frozen areas or if they're not working. If there's any issue with it, you just push right here on the inside and then you have the door handle free for you. I don't think it's something that's gonna have a problem with snow or ice or anything else. Do me a favor, let me just put the seats up for a second. I gotta have two hands, so I'll show you how that works, but bear with me. I apologize for the worst camera work there in around. So rear seat space, we did this yesterday, it's very good. I'm sitting behind myself. Now, right now, I am uncomfortably forward, and you can see my head is right on the ceiling. This is very square right now, right? That is perfect for a box in the back of the trunk. It would be set up really well on the trunk. And if you're only carrying, like my parents would only carry a poodle in the back seat, and might have some boxes in the back. So that would be a perfect way to just kind of have that square box sit across the back of the seat and the floor. When I recline, I can go way back. As I go way back, I'm pretty good. Now for me as a 6-footer, it gets a little tight right here all the way back, but I'm almost laying down. This is where I would like to be, maybe a little bit forward too, and it's totally fine for headroom. It looks like it gets really close there, but there's still plenty of room. So rear seat space is good. My legs are basically on the seat. Unlike Teslas. Teslas, I sit up like this, almost every type of Tesla, because of that raised floor and lowered seat to get the headroom. So you've got the headroom you need. And like I mentioned yesterday, there are USB ports back here, USB-C on the seat right there. So USB-C ports on here, USB-C ports around other places as well. All right, guys, I apologize. Oh, I'm gonna point out the radio, just a couple little things. All of these things we're gonna have better videos on in short forms. We're gonna do 5 minutes, we're gonna do 10 minutes, that kind of thing. Somebody asked me, does the headrest push your head at all? So these are weird looking headrests. I kind of like them because they look different, but somebody raised a good thing. They think they push very forward. Somebody thinks that maybe they pushed your head forward. I'll show you my head. It certainly would look like it would, right? Just the way they're designed there. But I'll show you how they fit me. They fit me very well. Now, I don't have a ponytail or anything else, but they line up nicely. So again, sitting comfortably, I have a lot of space. If I put it right back, like now I'm sitting uncomfortably back. So I don't think you're gonna have a problem with you. Some of the headrests sit really close to people's heads when they sit there in their driving position, and that's where I am right now. There is a lot of space back there. It's not something that I think will be an issue for most people, even though it looks like it kind of swoops forward. It fits very well. One thing I just want to show you with the radio, let's just do that for a second here. Let's flip around here. We're going to click on the radio. So again, radio options, you have a lot of things. You can go full screen, half screen. You can cycle through all kinds of different things. You've got some new fonts in there, you know, that kind of thing. And then we'll go full screen. So this is a Meridian sound system. And you have, if you get in the car and it sounds interesting, I can't play the stereo in here right now because we're in a sort of radio protected room. But you have the surround sound might be standard, the custom sound you can customize, and the authentic sound. So authentic would be more normal. It sounds really cool in the surround system for most music that I've played. Maybe it wouldn't sound cool on a talk show or something like that, but it is pretty cool. The Meridian sound system in here is really fantastic. So we've never had a Meridian sound system in a car that I'm aware of reviewing here. So very good sound system right there as well. Three adults sitting in the back can be comfortable. Yes, three adults can be comfortable. Let's be honest, two are going to be more comfortable than three, but there is enough width here to have, it's quite spacious. It's bigger than some of the other cars. Is there a launch control system on the EV6? I haven't tried any launch control system. What I can tell you is I was out this morning, obviously, maybe you saw my snow video. We did a snow video this morning. After that, I went on the roads as the snow started melting. There were still slick and wet roads. Flooring it in sport mode, this car hooked up. So it is, the traction control at speed is excellent. It just grabs and goes, does a very good job on that. Somebody says no launch control. Yeah, launch control in a gasoline car is where you build up the revs by letting your foot, hold your left foot on the brake and your right foot on the gas, and you let the revs build, and then you dump the clutch and it goes. You don't really need launch control so much in an electric vehicle that. Would I be able to do another video including a child seat installed? Yeah, we'll do a child seat installed in the future as well. Again, guys, I apologize for missing your questions here. Normally I try to get to them during the live video, but we are gonna cut this one short because I can't get to them. So feel free to ask your questions in the live video here. I'll go through them. I got some people helping me in the French questions. I'm gonna Google translate some of them later. And if you're not watching live with us, please fill the comment section. Tell us that you wanna see more of this car. Tell us you like that we do these videos, like these things, subscribe to them, because the more you guys do that, the more my bosses give me access to a car like this. Hey, I got a whole bunch of questions I got to answer. Here's what they're telling me. So it's just better for you, better for us. It's makes for my more fun days as well. Like I said, Monday and Tuesday, I can't be here. I've got some scheduled days that I have to be away. So no live video Monday and Tuesday, but we'll be back on Wednesday. And I do apologize if some of you are trying to get a hold of me. Just recognize that right now, it's very busy for me. I'm doing my best to get back to as many people as I can, but I may not hit everybody. I'm not sure how many voicemails I have. There are some emails that I'll try to get back to. I certainly won't hit every comment. I'll do my best to get back to as many of you as possible. But when this day is done, I am done till Wednesday, and we'll see you then. So thank you everybody for joining us. I hope this was helpful so far. And like I said, my intention now is to go through this car and do those 5 or 7 minute videos to dig into individual features from now on. So we'll of course do a longer one if we need to as well. But lots coming up. I do also intend to compare this car directly to the Equal Ioniq 5. I should have that together soon as well. So I think that'll be a good comparison. Some of you are asking me which one I prefer, and which one I prefer doesn't really matter. But there will be a comparison between the two to help you decide which one you might prefer. And of course, if you're in Ontario, we'll help you buy it. So thanks everybody for watching. If there's 9 more people that want to give us a like, we'll get to 200 before we're done. You can go ahead and hit the like button right now. Other than that, I'm going to check out right now and finish this week off. I want to thank you guys for joining us. We will have more. Talk to you soon.